My kid just got on the annual conference. There's more to say.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here today. My name is Shusmita Shah. Some of you have asked me how I decided to organize this talk. At the heart of my response is this. If there's one thing that has helped me in my personal life and my work as a psychotherapist is recognizing quickly when I meet someone from whom I need to learn. So this is how I ended up finding Dr. Peter Gray. I am thrilled to have this opportunity for us to learn from him today on what exactly is play, why is play so valuable for children's healthy intellectual, social, and emotional development. Dr. Gray is a research professor at Boston College. He is also the author of a recently published book, Free to Learn. Please be sure to stay with us for a book sale and book signing at the end of this talk, and it's down the hallway. And please welcome Dr. Peter Gray.
Thank you. I guess you don't have the handout. I have a handout here, which maybe you can just, do you want to just pass it around? That would be great. I'll keep a couple of copies up here. I just got off the plane about an hour ago from Boston, so it's been a long day, but I think I'll make it through. Thank you all for coming. It's great to see you. This handout gives an outline of what I'm going to be talking about. The bulk of what I'm going to be talking about is under Roman numeral 2 on the handout. What exactly is play, and why is it such a powerful vehicle for learning? I'm going to introduce it, however, with what I have under Roman numeral 1, which will give you some idea of why I think this is such an important topic, why it is really important for us to understand what play is, what it is we're depriving children of when we don't allow them to play, which as a culture, we currently are not allowing children to play. And then the final section, section 3 on the other side of the page is going to be just a summary in a way. Can everybody hear me all right? I'm assuming the microphone is working okay. So I'm an evolutionary psychologist, which means that I'm interested in human nature, and I'm interested in how human nature came about by natural selection. And I'm particularly interested in the nature of human children, and especially interested in that aspect of children's nature that leads them to become educated. Because throughout human history, until very recent times, education was always children's responsibility. Adults didn't educate children, yet children educated themselves. Children educated themselves by observing, by questioning, by paying attention. They educated themselves the same way our little children still educate themselves. Think of what children learn. They learn language. They learn so much about the world around them just by paying attention. And I've studied children in settings where they continue to learn that way into their teenage years, where nobody's instructing them, nobody's forcing them to learn, and they continue to learn through their own play and their own curiosity. So we live in a world today where children are seriously deprived of the opportunity to play freely. And as I talk about play, I'm going to get rid of the term free play. I'm not going to call it free play, because if it's not free, it's not play in my definition of play. So we, over the past 60 years, really over the period of my lifetime, I'm 70, I'll give you that information right off the bat. Over the period of my lifetime, we have seen a tragic decline in children's freedom. We are currently a society in which children are less free than they have ever been in human history, outside of periods of slavery and outside of periods in which they were in sweatshops or other child labor situations. Children throughout history and throughout the world have spent most of their time with other kids playing, and in the process learning the skills that they need to become adults, including emotional and social skills, as well as intellectual skills, as well as physical skills. Children are designed to learn that way, but we don't let them do that very much anymore. And I've seen this change, as I said, in the course of my life. In the 1950s, when I was a kid, you could walk down any street in the United States and you would find kids outdoors playing with no adult in sight. Kids were trusted. By the age of five, I could go just about anywhere in town, as long as I was with at least one friend. My mother didn't want me to go anywhere just all by myself, but my friend was just six, or sometimes the same age as me. So this was a different period of time. It wasn't really any more dangerous. It wasn't really any less dangerous then than it is now, but we think it's so much more dangerous now, so we don't allow our children to go out and play on their own. Over this same period of time, that there has been this continuous, what I should say, first of all, is that since the 1950s, there's been a continuous decline in children's opportunities to play freely. It's been probably a kind of a linear decline. It's hard to exactly quantify it. But with every 10 years, children are less free to play outdoors on their own than they were in the previous 10 years. And this decline has been going on since the 1950s. Over this same period of time that we have seen this dramatic decline in children's opportunities to play freely, we have seen dramatic increases in all forms of childhood psychopathology. It's not just that we are observing problems that we didn't look for before. Even by standard clinical questionnaires, which have been constant and given to normative groups since the 1950s, there have been dramatic increases in such disorders as depression and anxiety disorders. So, for example, the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, the MMPI, has a scale for depression. And there's a version of this, of the MMPI, that's for adolescents. And when you look at the normative scores and you take what would be the cutoff score on that scale for suspected major depression today, and you look at how many would have been above that cutoff in the 1950s or the 1970s, the 1990s, or today, what you find is that with every decade, there's a greater number above that cutoff, such that today there's something like eight times, the rate of major depression is about eight times today among young people as it was in the 1950s. Similarly with anxiety disorders, there's a test for a scale for anxiety called Taylor's Manifest Anxiety Scale, which has been used with normative groups of young people since the 1950s. And anxiety disorders are something like five to eight times as prevalent today by that measure. Just to give you a little illustration of this, because it's one thing to say, you know, these are scores on the scale, let me just read some of the questions. These are questions from the MMPI that have remained constant over the years. I couldn't find data that was the exact percentages who answered a specific way in a particular question for today, but I found such data for 1948 and for 1989. And so here's one question on the MMPI. I wake up fresh and rested most mornings. In 1948, and this is with children who were age 14 to 16, in 1948, 75% of children in that age range said they woke up fresh and rested most mornings. By 1989, it was 31%. In 1948, 16% said yes to, "I work under a great deal of tension." 16% is already too many. But by 1989, it was 42% who said, "I work under a great deal." We're talking about teenagers. "Life is a strain for me much of the time." In 1948, 9% agreed with that. By 1989, 35% agreed with that. I have certainly had more than my share of things to worry about. In 1948, 22% agreed with that. In 1989, 55% agreed with that. And here's one that kind of blows my mind. I am afraid of losing my mind. In 1948, 4% agreed with that. By 1989, 23% agreed with that. And the people who do this tell me that these statistics would be even worse today if I could find the actual percentages, because the overall depression score has increased even greater since between 1989 and now than it was before. So we've seen a dramatic rise in anxiety and depression. There's another questionnaire that has been given in unchanged form over the years since about 1960 when it was first developed, and that's Rotter's internal-external locus of control scale. Locus of control assesses the degree to which a person feels that they control their own fate and their own behavior. That's an internal locus of control versus the degree to which they feel that they are victims of circumstances around them, that they do not have control over what happens to them. Now, in reality, of course, you would think that we have more control today than people would have had in the 1960s or at any earlier time. We've learned to control diseases. We've done away with a lot of the prejudices that held people back. We've done away with, you know, but yet, when you look at this scale, what you find, especially when you're looking at young people, not so much when you're looking at older people, but when you're looking at young people, there has been a continuous decline in the degree to which people feel that they are in control of their own lives, that they're in control of their own fate. And one thing that clinical psychologists know very well is that if you don't believe you're in control of your own fate, that sets you up for anxiety and depression, because you believe the world is scary if you can't control things. In fact, if you can't control things, the world is scary. If you don't feel you can solve the problems around you, if you don't feel you can solve your own problem, if you don't feel you can handle things and in some sense direct your own fate, that sets you up for anxiety and depression. So this decline in control is presumably at least part of why we see the increased rates of depression and anxiety in young people. You may not be impressed by questionnaire data, but here's another hard, cold fact. Suicides have increased since the 1950s. They've doubled among young people between the age of 15 and 24. They've almost quadrupled among children who are under age 15 since the 1950s. And again, it hasn't been a completely linear trend, but again, it's been largely a linear trend since that time, paralleling, not surprisingly, the increase in depression. In addition to this, clinical assessment questionnaires that measure social attitudes and social behavior. So for example, there's a scale that assesses empathy, which has been around since the 1970s, since the mid to late 1970s. And ever since that scale has been used with young people, empathy has been declining. Empathy, of course, measures the degree to which you relate to other people's emotions, to which you feel what they're feeling. Empathy is believed to be the foundation for human morality. In order to really care about other people, we need to kind of feel what they're feeling, feel their pain, feel their sorrow, feel their joys, and so on and so forth. Apparently, the capacity to do that, or the tendency to do that, has been gradually declining among young people since about the mid-1970s. At the same time, not surprisingly, there's another scale also developed in the 1970s that assesses narcissism. And narcissism has been increasing over these same years in young people. The narcissism, of course, refers to an inflated view of yourself, which makes it difficult for you to form real relationships with other people because you're primarily concerned about yourself. You don't really, in a sense, the high narcissism is the mirror image of of empathy. So narcissism has been increasing, empathy has been declining. One more bit of bad news, there's also, believe it or not, there's a way of assessing creativity, which has been pretty well validated, a set of tests called Torrance's Tests of Creative Thinking, which have been used at all grade levels among school children, at least since the 1960s or 70s. And since about 1980, there's been a continuous decline at all grade levels in creativity as measured in this way. So as we have created a world in which children are less free to play on their own, in which they are spending more and more of their time in school and at school-like things out of school, and in settings generally where they're being watched and directed by adults, we've seen very serious deleterious changes in young people. We've seen a rise in anxiety and depression, a decline in sense of control over their own behavior, a rise in narcissism, a decline in empathy, a decline in creativity. Now, this is all correlation, and any social scientist will tell you, correlation doesn't prove cause and effect. But I think in this case, there's powerful reason for believing that there's a causal relationship between the decline in children's freedom to play and explore and learn on their own and all these other deleterious changes. And that's really what I want to demonstrate to you as I talk about what play really is. I might also mention, you know, we can't do experiments with human beings where we randomly assign some to the play deprivation group and others to the plenty of play group and we look at differences. We can't do that kind of an experiment that would be the ideal way to test causality. We can do it with animals, though, and there have been such experiments done in the past with monkeys and more recently, because nowadays it would be regarded as cruel to deprive monkeys of play. Nowadays, done more often with rats. And when we do those experiments, what is found is that the animals grow up as emotional and social cripples. They are unable to handle fearful situations and adapt to them normally. They are unable to handle anger and deal with it constructively. And they don't know how to get along with their peers. Not surprisingly, if they're not allowed to play. In other words, these are effects very analogous to the kinds of effects that have been documented. Our children are not as severely deprived of play as the monkeys and rats in those experiments, but the fact that they're deprived considerably of play and the direction of the effects is the same is, I think, telling. So what exactly is play? Why is it such a powerful vehicle for learning? That's really the primary thing that I'm here to talk about. Play is a concept that fills our minds with contradictions when we think about it. Play is serious, yet not serious. It's trivial, yet it's profound. It is imaginative and spontaneous, yet I'm going to argue it is always bound by rules. It's really how children learn to follow rules. Play is not real. It takes place in the fantasy world, but yet it's about the real world. And it is how children learn to adapt to the real world. It's how they learn to solve problems related to the real world. Play is childish, but yet it underlies the greatest achievements of adults. Play, from a biological perspective, from my perspective, is nature's way of ensuring that children and other young mammals, because other young mammals play too, acquire and practice the skills that they need to practice in order to become effective adults. That's why play came about in evolution. From a religious perspective, we might say that play is God's gift that makes life on earth worthwhile. And this is what we are depriving our children of, because we are so afraid that somebody's going to snatch them away if we let them out to play. Children everywhere, when they are free to do so, play in certain universal ways. And if you think about the different ways that they play, they match rather nicely onto the kinds of skills that human beings everywhere have to develop to grow into effective adults. There's physical locomotor play, the same kind of play that animals engage in, running and chasing and play fighting and climbing trees and all of these things that develop fit bodies and prevent you from becoming obese and allow you to develop coordinated, beautiful bodies and allow you to do things with your hands. These are all developed in physical play. There's linguistic play. I don't think I put that one on your list, but human beings everywhere have to learn language. And if you've watched any child, if you've watched your own baby or another baby learning language, you know that language is learned playfully. The first words are babbled in a playful way, and the first babbling occurs in a playful way as a way of practicing, and then the first words are used playfully. They're not used to really ask for something. They're used playfully. Play, and then as children get older, they're playing constantly with language. Young kids are like poets. They're putting words together in new and novel ways to try them out, experiment with them. There is constructive play. We are the animal that lives by making things. We always have been. We create things. We create conveyances for ourselves. We create tools for getting food and so on and so forth. So it's not surprising that children everywhere play at making things with their hands. We are the animal that is capable of imagination. We're the only animal that presumably that can think about the future, think about things that haven't actually happened yet, can imagine a world that isn't already present. And we use this in our logical thinking. It's really the foundation for what we think of as abstract, hypothetical thinking, is really the capacity for imagination. And so it's not surprising that children play all over the world in ways in which they are exercising their imagination in fantasy play, or what is called, when it's more than one child playing together, sociodramatic play, what would be called improvisational acting if it were adults doing it. And then there's games with formal rules. Games in our culture, they might be games like Candyland or chess or baseball, in which there's prescribed rules that you are supposed to follow. You might vary the rules, but there's clearly a set of rules that you are supposed to follow that are explicit rules as opposed to the more implicit rules of other kinds of play. And human beings everywhere need to be able to follow explicit rules. They need to be able to make agreements and abide by those agreements and so on. And so that kind of play is exercising that kind of ability. So these are some of the ways that children play, and they match on to some of the skills that human beings everywhere have to develop. But still, what really is play? What exactly makes an activity play versus not play? It's not so much what you're doing as the attitude that you bring to it when you are doing it that makes it play versus not play. So if you look at the handout, I have listed five different characteristics, defining characteristics of play. And I should say at the outset that play is not necessarily all or none. An activity can be more or less playful. And in fact, when we're talking about adult play, we're usually talking about something that is not fully play, that is more or less playful. And with children, it may be really pure full play, but not everything that they're doing is full play. It might be partly play. So to the degree that an activity contains these characteristics, I would say that activity is play. Now, I didn't make these up just out of the air. I came to this list in part, at least, by looking at all of the literature I could find on play, the classic books on play, the classic works on play, the ways that play is identified by play researchers. And I tried to extract all of the definitions that others had given and put them together. And this is what I came up with, is these five characteristics. So the first characteristic that I've listed here is that play is self-chosen and self-directed. Play, first and foremost, is an expression of freedom. Play is always voluntary. If it's not voluntary, it's not play. It is what one wants to do as opposed to what one has to do. Play is not always accompanied by smiles and laughter, and smiles and laughter are not always indexes of play. But play always is accompanied by the feeling of, yes, this is exactly what I want to do right now. This is what I want to do. That's the primary defining characteristic of play, is it's what you want to do as opposed to what somebody else is telling you to do, or as opposed to what you feel you must do or have to do. It's what you want to do. Play is not only, though, self-chosen, but it's self-directed. So players not only decide to play, but they decide how to play. They direct their own activity. This is why Little League is not play, because somebody else is telling them what to do and when to do it and how to do it. Whereas a pickup game of baseball is play, because you are making the rules. You are figuring it out. You are in control. In social play, in other words, play that involves more than one person, you have to make the rules together. You have to figure out together what the rules are. And you have to do it in such a way that the other players agree. I can't just dictate, if we're playing a game together, I can't just dictate what we're going to do, because if I do that, and if I don't pay any attention to what you want to do, you'll just quit. And there will be no game at all. The capacity to quit is really what gives play its ultimate power. If you can't quit, just as you you're free to join and play, you're free to quit. If you can't quit, it's not play. And it's the fact that any player can quit at any time that forces us to overcome narcissism. I cannot have my way if I'm going to play with you. I've got to compromise. I've got to figure out some way of playing that will please you as well as me. That means that I've got to get into your mind. I might just be 4 years old, but I've got to get into your mind. I've got to figure out what will make you happy, and I've got to play in a way that will make you happy while still meeting my own needs, because if I fail at that, you will leave me, and that's the last thing I want, is to be left alone. So play is the root, social play is the root of overcoming narcissism. Social play is the most democratic of all activities, because if you attempt to dominate somebody else in play, it's no longer play. The one being dominated will simply quit. As long as you are in a situation where it's really play, where you're not caged in there together, like in a school recess, where you have to be there. That's where bullying occurs, because you can't get away from it. But in freely chosen play, in the kind of neighborhood play that used to be very common, you could come and go. And if somebody bullied you, you would just leave them alone. And bullies very often learn that they can't bully because they got tired of being left alone. So think about the difference between a pickup game of baseball, which is play, and a Little League game of baseball, which is not play. Think about the differences in what you learn in the two games. In the pickup game, in order to have the game, you've got to, first of all, on your own initiative, get there. You've got to get the other people there or find them there. You've got to choose up teams. You've got to coordinate the rules. You've got to figure out the rules, given this is the size of the lot, this is how many players we've got, and so on and so forth. What are the rules are going to be? You've got to negotiate all this, because you've got to do it in a way that everybody's agreeable. So in the Little League, in the pickup game, what are you practicing? You are practicing all of those things that I said are declining. You're practicing locus of control. We are in control of this game. We're not dependent upon a coach telling us what to do. We are in control. We're figuring this out. We're solving the problem. You're practicing internal control. In a Little League game, you're not practicing that. You're being controlled externally by the coach who's telling you what to do. You are practicing empathy, because in order to play this game, you've got to empathize. If you are, you know, if you're a 12-year-old, pretty tough kid as pitcher, and the batter up is 8 and is kind of a novice, you're not going to throw your hardest pitch to that 8-year-old novice, because That'll be no fun. It'll be no fun for you, and it'll be no fun for him. Pleasing the other players in the pickup game is more important than winning. Because if you don't please the other players, even the players on the other team, then the game is over because people will just go home. They won't have any fun. Having fun is the essence of the pickup game, not winning. Nobody really cares about winning. Everybody might cheer wildly when their team scores a point. That's great fun. But in the end, nobody really cares what the score is. There's nobody keeping track. It's only when adults become involved that people start keeping track and caring about winning. Kids don't naturally care about winning. But adults seem to want to impose that upon children. And we do it all the time. We do it in our schools. We do it in adult-led sports and so on and so forth. We make winning more important than fun. No matter what we might say, our practice when we're doing these things is making winning, beating the other person or beating the other team becomes more important than pleasing the other person or pleasing the other team. You're also, of course, practicing creativity in the pickup game. You are creating the rules. You're figuring things out. You are innovating. Every pickup game is different from every other game in terms of the rules because you have to make up the rules to fit the circumstances. So that's the first point about play, that it's freely chosen and self-directed. Second point about play, second characteristic. Play is motivated by means more than ends. In play, we value our actions more than the results of our actions, is another way of saying that. So many of our actions are free in the sense that nobody else is making us do them, but they are not free in another sense, or they don't seem to be free in another sense, because we feel compelled to do them because we have to do them to get something that we really want or something that we really need. So we scratch an itch to get rid of the itch, or we run away from a tiger to avoid being eaten by the tiger, or we study a boring book to get a good grade on a test, or we work at a boring job to get a paycheck. These are not play because we are not doing them because we enjoy the process of doing them, but we're doing them to get something that we need. We're doing them for the end result. In those activities, the end is more important than the means. We would do whatever it took to get rid of the itch, or to get away from the tiger, or to get the paycheck, or to get the high grade on the test. And we prefer to take the shortest, most direct route to the goal. That's not play. To the degree that an activity is purely done to achieve some end or goal, it's not play. But to the degree that you are doing the activity for the activity itself, and the end or goal is less important, or is only important to the degree that it relates to the activity itself, then it's play. So think about the difference, for example, between a cat preying on a mouse and a cat playing at preying on a mouse. The cat who's preying on a mouse has the goal in mind of getting that delicious mouse. It will take the most direct route to getting that goal, to that goal. The cat who's playing at preying on the mouse, however, will take a less direct route, will fumble around, catch the mouse, let it go, and do it again, and do it again, and do it again. The cat who's playing at preying at the mouse isn't goal-directed towards getting the mouse. It is playing at getting the mouse, and it is practicing getting the mouse. The mouse to the cat who's preying is food. The mouse to the cat who's playing is a toy. So that difference between whether you're doing the activity for its own sake or you're doing the activity for an end. Another way of saying all this is to say that play is intrinsically motivated. It's motivated by the activity itself, whereas what non-play is extrinsically motivated. It's motivated by the goal, the trophy you get, or the prize you get, or the money you get, or whatever, or the praise you get, or whatever it is that is your goal. Play often does have goals, but the goals are are an intrinsic part of the game. They're not the sole reason for doing it. They're not something that you would want independent of getting it. So for example, constructive play, there's always the goal of constructing the thing that you have in mind. So think of children building a sandcastle. Are they building the sandcastle because they really want a sandcastle? Or are they building the sandcastle because they want to experience the joy of building a sandcastle? If you came along to children who are building a sandcastle and you said, oh, you can stop all your hard work now, I'll build it for you, they would not be happy about that because it's the building, not the having of the sandcastle. The sandcastle is just going to wash away into the sea anyway. So that's the distinction between the goal in play. The goal in play is the creation of the goal, not really the having of the goal. Similarly, if you're playing a competitive game and you're really playing the game, you're not in a you're not in the kind of adult-led competition that we so often put our children in, but you're really playing the game, you might have the goal of scoring points and winning. But it is the scoring of the points, and it is the winning that is the pleasure. It is not the points at the end. It is not the trophy at the end. It is not the praise at the end. It is not. If you would just as soon win by cheating, or if you would just as soon win the trophy, get the trophy by some means other than going through the actions of actually playing and winning, to that degree, it's not play at all. Rewards can, in some cases, undermine play. There are actually a lot of experiments along this line. The classic experiment was done quite some years ago by researchers named Mark Leber and David Green. They performed this experiment with children in a preschool, and they observed that these children, turns out all the children in this particular preschool liked to play with magic markers, with felt tip pens. And they all spend a certain amount of time doing this. What these researchers did is they randomly assigned the kids to two different groups. One group went through an experience where they were given a reward for playing with magic markers. There was a setting set up. They said there's going to be a visitor coming, and we would like you to draw a nice picture with magic markers for the visitor. And if you do so, we'll give you this good player certificate, very beautiful certificate with a gold star on it and all that. And the kids really wanted that certificate, and they did it. Another group of kids was told, we'll have a visitor coming, and if you'd like to draw a picture for him, that's fine. And we're allowed to draw a picture, and most of them drew a picture. They wanted to draw a picture, but they weren't given any reward for it. They weren't promised any reward for it. So then there were two results of that experiment. The first result is, lo and behold, the kids who were not rewarded for drawing a picture for the visitor drew better pictures than the ones who were rewarded. They were doing it for play. They were involved in it. They were doing it for fun, and they put their effort into it. Those who were doing it for the reward figured, well, all I need to do is draw a picture, and I'll get the reward. There was nothing said that it has to be a good picture. So they just drew the picture to get the reward, and they just drew something quickly, and it was okay. That was the first finding. The second finding, even more telling, was this. When the kids were observed later on, for some days later on, those kids who had been asked to draw a picture for a reward were discovered to do a lot less drawing with magic markers after that. Those who had just done it for fun continued to draw with magic markers at the same rate that they had before. In other words, being given a reward for it turns something that was fun and play mentally into work. This is something you do for a reward, not something you do for fun. Think of how often we do that in school. We do that all the time in school. Every time we reward a child for reading, we are telling that child reading is work. It's not fun, it's something you do for a reward. Every time, and our schools operate entirely this way. We motivate children externally because we don't believe that they're going to learn through play. And in the process, we turn all of these great activities, include arithmetic, math, which is fun for people who are playing with it, we turn it into work. We turn it into something that people do in the minimal way that they have to do to get whatever grade they want in school, but As soon as they don't have to do it anymore, they don't do it. Okay, the third characteristics that I've listed here is play is guided by mental rules. Play is freely chosen activity, but it is not free-form activity. It's not random activity. Play always has structure. And the structure comes from some set of concepts that you have in your head, some set of rules that you have in your head about what you want to do, about what it is you're doing. So in play, the child is always controlling his or her behavior in accordance with some ideas that he or she has in her head. Not behaving by whim, not behaving by instinct, not behaving whimsically, but rather behaving in accordance with a conscious conception of what it is that you are trying to do, what it is that you want to do. All forms of play have rules. Even rough and tumble play may look wild and ruleless, but if you look carefully at it, the difference between a play fight and a real fight is a play fight has rules. They are generally not stated out loud, but they're implied, and all the play fighters recognize them. You don't bite. You don't kick, you don't scratch, you don't really hurt the other person. In some sense, a play fight is the exact opposite of a real fight. You're going through the motions of a fight, but you are doing the opposite thing from a real fight. Instead of trying to end it by defeating the other person, you're trying to prolong it by pleasing the other person. If you are the stronger, more capable person, you have to self-handicap in some way so that the other person has fun. You cannot dominate the other person or it's over. So play fight is really an exercise in restraint, whereas a real fight is not an exercise in restraint. In constructive play, the rule is that you are creating something that you have in mind. You are building something. You are working towards that goal of creating that something. In sociodramatic play, the main rule is that you have to stay in character. If you are the mommy in a game of house, you have to behave in accordance with how you and your playmates think a mommy behaves. If you're Wonder Woman, you have to behave in the way you think Wonder Woman behaves. If you believe that Wonder Woman never cries and you fall down and hurt yourself, you don't cry because you are Wonder Woman and you can't cry. If you're the pet dog in a game, you have to, no matter how much you don't want to, you have to walk around on all fours and bark instead of talk. Children are amazingly capable of controlling their behavior and even doing uncomfortable things for prolonged periods of time in play. They want to do this. They desire to do this. This is how they learn to control their own behavior. The great Russian psychologist Lev Vygotsky, who was really the first in writing to point out the rule-based nature of play and argued that maybe the most important thing that children learn to play is to control their behavior, gave an example that is kind of a nice example of two little girls who really in real life were sisters. But he contrasted them being sisters in real life and how they behaved when they were pretending to be sisters. So these two sisters would sometimes pretend to be sisters. So in real life, of course, they behaved like in all the various ways. It's just sometimes they ignored one another, sometimes they fought, sometimes they agreed with one another, and so on and so forth. There was no real predictability to how, but when they played, they were sisters. They walked around with their arms around one another. They dressed the same. They loved one another. They hated everybody else. They acted in a stereotype view of what it is to be a sister. Now, Vygotsky points out, in a way, this is a skill that we all have to develop to become adults. All of us, human beings, unlike other animals, we don't behave by whims. We behave in accordance with certain social conventions. There are certain things I'm allowed to do right now here as lecturer and other things I'm not allowed to do right now. And I have to control my behavior in accordance with that. There are certain things you're allowed to do there as the audience right now. We're all playing parts in a way. And this is true in all human societies. And children are constantly practicing playing parts, when they're playing in sociodramatic ways. And so it's not surprising that children in all cultures play in these ways. They're practicing, as Vygotsky would put it, the art of being a human being as opposed to being an animal. As human beings, we behave in accordance with social customs and social agreements. We don't behave in accordance just with instinct or whim. So play is really then nature's way of teaching children to control their impulses. We don't have data that would support this, but I wouldn't be too surprised if the high incidence of ADHD today is at least partly the result of the lack of play. I think that it's largely the result of diagnoses of normal behavior, especially normal boy behavior, as being a mental illness, because you can't sit in the classroom hour after hour doing what you're told to do. But I also think there might be something to the idea that children are more impulsive than they were in the past. There are some people who have argued this. And if they are more impulsive than they were in the past, are less able to control their behavior in accordance with social expectations, maybe, just maybe, it's partly at least because of the deprivation of play, of free play in which they're practicing these things. Okay, characteristic four, play is imaginative. Play always involves at least some element of imagination or fantasy. It is always in some ways removed mentally from the real world. This is most obvious in sociodramatic play, where children are constructing a fictitious story and acting it out and creating characters and imagining a fictitious scene. Imagination is at the core of this kind of play, and that's why it's also called imaginative play or fantasy play. But imagination is involved in all other forms of play as well. So, for example, in rough and tumble play, it's a pretend fight. It's not a real fight. You're just imagining that it's a fight. In constructive play, the players may say they're building a castle, but they know it's not a real castle. They're building an imaginary castle. In formal games with explicit rules, you might think the element of imagination is not so much there, but there's a sense at least in which it also is. So think of any game, and to be in that game, you have to accept a certain imagined scene, a certain imagined set of constraints. So for example, in chess, you are imagining that bishops can only move on the diagonal. Bishops in the real world can move wherever they want, but bishops on the chessboard can only move in the diagonal. This is not reality. This is an imagined world that you have agreed to enter into when you're playing chess. And the same is true for every other game. You're entering into a world that has certain imagined constraints and possibilities within it. So all sorts of play have time in and time out. Time in is the period of fantasy. It's the period in which you are in the fictitious world. Time out is the return to reality, whether it's to tie your shoes or go to the bathroom or to correct a playmate who's not following the rules. And then once that's done, you go back to the element of fantasy. When you are in time in, you never say that you're playing, because that would break the magic spell. When you are time in, you say, I am the dragon. You don't say, I am pretending to be the dragon. Sometimes this confuses adults. They get confused by this. I remember when my son was 4 years old, he was Superman for periods that sometimes lasted for several days. He put on his cape, and you couldn't take his cape off, and he was Superman. And you would say to him, you're just pretending to be Superman. No, I am Superman. And this, I recall, disturbed his nursery school teacher to some degree. She had to have us in and consult and thinking. And I tried to assure her that he was not going to leap off of actual tall buildings. He was not going to try to stop railroad trains by his bare hands, that he has never done that when he's playing Superman. And that at some point, he would take off his cape, and then if she asked him, he would say that he was had been only pretending. To say a child at play is no more likely to say, I'm only pretending to do this, than Shakespeare's Hamlet on the stage would say, I'm only pretending to kill my stepfather. When you are in the play, you are that individual. You are what you are pretending to be. You are not pretending to be what you're pretending to be. And play then involves continuous training of the imagination. And as I said before, imagination is I keep giving these things that distinguish us from the other animals, and imagination is certainly in that one of those things. The things that we think of as the greatest achievements of human beings really practically all involve imagination. Certainly those things that involve invention and creation involve imagination. An architect designing a house is designing a real house, but there's another sense in which she is designing a playhouse. She's imagining a house that doesn't exist. She's imagining the people and what they would do there. She's imagining how they would move through this house. She is creating a pretend house in her mind and then on paper as a route to creating a real house. Scientists go beyond just collecting data. The data itself isn't very helpful. You've got to then do something with the data. You've got to think about, imagine what might make sense of this data. You develop hypotheses. This kind of hypothetical thinking always involves imagination and the development of constructs like gravity, which you've never seen. But you develop a construct that explains what you do see. This is all imagination. Geniuses seem to be those people who are capable of retaining throughout their lives the imagination of young children, but they even build on that imagination. They don't lose it. Einstein, for example, considered all of his greatest achievements in physics and mathematics, theoretical physics and mathematics, to be play. He called it, he referred to it as mental play. He was famously described his development of the theory of relativity as coming through imagining what it would be like to chase a sunbeam and catch up to it. That the ability to imagine a scene like that and play it out in your mind. And that's really, in a way, what all scientists do when they go beyond the data. But you don't have to be a scientist to do this. We all do this. Whenever we think about tomorrow, we are using our imagination to construct scenarios of what happened tomorrow. The ability to plan absolutely depends upon imagination. And so children are constantly practicing this ability in their imaginative play. Fifth characteristic, play is conducted in an alert, active, but non-stressed frame of mind. This characteristic follows naturally from the other characteristics, if you think about it. Because play involves conscious control of your behavior, the following of rules, the attention to means, it can never be passive. Play always is active. It requires an active mind. But at the same time that it requires this active, alert mind, it also does not produce much stress. It may produce a certain amount of stress, but not much, because if it produced a lot of stress, you would just quit. If it was painful, you would quit. It doesn't produce a lot of stress because the consequences don't matter. This is in a fantasy world. You're free to fail. You're trying hard. You want to do well, but if you don't, so what? There's no trophy lost, because if there was a trophy, it wasn't play. There's no praise lost, because if you're doing it for praise, it wasn't play. When it's play, you are doing it for its own sake. And so in play, children and adults too in play are free to fail. We don't worry about failure. We can courageously try new things. We can think about new things. We can do things that we can't already do, because it doesn't matter if we fail. We want to succeed. Our play drive, our drive, our attention to means wants us to do it well in accordance with our conception of what we're trying to do. But no big deal if it fails. So it turns out that the playful state of mind is the ideal state of mind for learning new things. There have been many experiments of this sort. You put one group of your experimental subjects into what you might call the play condition. It's usually not called that, but I would call it that, where they're just doing this for the sake of doing it, for fun. And nobody's watching them. You're not going to measure how they did, and so on and so forth. The other group, you're putting them into a school-like situation. You're saying, we're going to assess your score. We're going to measure it. We might even give we'll give you a prize if you do well on this. In study after study in psychology laboratories, when you do this kind of a thing, you find that those that are in the play group do better than those that are in the non-play group. So whether it's learning something new, whether it's creating a creative picture, whether it's solving some kind of a problem, I won't take the time right now to describe the whole problem, but there's a classic problem called the candle problem. When you give it to college students, typically only about 15% of them, when you're in the usual experimental setting, is something where the college student feels like the experimenter is sort of like a teacher and you're being judged on this. About 15% of people solve this problem. There's a woman named Alice Eisen at Cornell who did this experiment where she did it in the typical way, and then she also did it another way, where she set up a playful mood by having the students watch a slapstick comedy for a few minutes beforehand. They gave the notion, oh, this is just all fun and play. 75% of the students solved the problem correctly in that condition, whereas again, it was only 15% in the other condition. These are huge effects. You rarely get effects like this in psychological experiments. The playful state of mind enables people to make connections and see things new that they couldn't see before. The non-playful state of mind is a good state of mind for doing things that you already know how to do. So if you do an experiment, and there are experiments done also along this line, you take one group of people who are experts at something, and another group of people who are novices. They're just learning this thing. One such experiment has been done with the game of billiards. But there are also experiments done in solving math problems and in all kinds of things. And you then test each group under two different conditions. You divide them now into two different conditions. One group is being observed and they're being evaluated. The other group is just playing at the thing. What you find is that the people who are already good at it become even better when they're being observed and evaluated. They like to be observed and evaluated. That gives them more, they work harder at it than they otherwise would, and they do even better than they otherwise would. But the opposite is true for the novices. Observing and judging makes them worse. And then we wonder why it is that we have this continuing gap in our educational world. As you go from grade to grade, those kids, maybe because they came from impoverished homes and didn't already know how to read when they started school, fall farther and farther behind, whereas those who already knew how to read get higher and higher and higher as you go from grade to grade. And the more repressive our schools become, the more test-oriented they become, the more observant, and the less playful they become, the bigger that gap has become. That gap is bigger now than it ever has been before between the rich and the poor and how they perform in school. So I would argue that this phenomenon that I'm just describing helps explain something that's really quite awful that's happening in school. Those who already know how to do it really shine in school. Those who don't know how to do it, they're in exactly the wrong setting for learning it. They're in a setting where they're being evaluated and judged, and that's the worst kind of setting for learning something new. So I made this point under item C here. The power of play lies in its triviality. People often think of play as frivolous or trivial, and they are right. It is frivolous and trivial. If it wasn't, it wouldn't be play. It's frivolous and trivial because you're not doing it for some serious end. You're not doing it to get food. You're not doing it to get praise. You're not doing it to get a trophy. You're not doing it to build your resume. You're doing it just for the heck of it. You're doing it just because you want to do it. So in that sense, it is frivolous. It is trivial. But it's precisely because of that that you feel free to try new things. You feel free to experiment. You feel free to fail. And it's because of that freedom that you then learn new things that then later on can be applied to the real world. The play world is a simulation world for practicing the skills that you will need in the real world. And once if you take that simulation world and you try to turn it into a serious world where there are rewards and punishments, you destroy the whole thing. It's no longer a simulation world. Play is trivial, but it's not easy. If once an activity becomes easy, it becomes boring and nobody wants to do it anymore, and therefore it's not play anymore. So children in play are always at the cutting edge. They're always pushing the cutting edge of their abilities. So toddlers who are playfully learning to walk, once walking is easy, then they move on to running or jumping or climbing. They move on to harder things. Teenagers playing video games, they start at level one, but that gets boring after a while. Now they're on to level two and they continuously raise the level. Einstein, playing with these mental concepts, was continuously moving from one concept to a more difficult one as his play progressed. So children who are free to play, play naturally at an ever-advancing edges of their mental and physical abilities. Now, this last part I'm going to just spend about 2 minutes on because I want to leave some time for questions and discussion, is really just the section, Roman numeral 3 here, is really just a kind of summary of the points I've already made, or at least part of it is. What and how children learn through play. These are the aspects of development that play promotes. One, play and physical development. I haven't really talked about that. I'm a psychologist and I'm interested in mental development. But in play, physical play, children are developing strength, they're developing heart and lung capacity, they're developing graceful movements, they're developing all kinds of really important skills. They're burning up calories. They are developing fit bodies, just as animals are in their kind of active play. Play and intellectual development, play and mental intellectual development. I've talked about how play provides a basis for learning to be creative, for learning insight, for taking initiative in mental activities as well as other activities. Children behave at higher, there are actually a number of experiments, some of which I could describe, where young children can solve syllogisms that Piaget claimed they couldn't solve. There were certain syllogisms that Piaget felt children can't solve until about 12 or 13 years old when they reach formal operations. Turns out 4-year-olds can solve those syllogisms, the very ones Piaget used, if you put them in a playful frame of mind. And you say, this is play. And you present the syllogism in the context of play. Children behave at a higher cognitive level in play than they do when they believe they're being judged, and they're continuously advancing their ability to think abstractly and logically. Play and social moral development. I've described how play requires that you see from the perspective of the other people. The most important aspect of a social being is that we can see from the other perspective. I often like to say that the golden rule is too simple. We can't live by the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If I did unto you exactly what I would want you to do unto me, you wouldn't like it. So I have to be smarter than that. I have to say, do unto others what they would want me to do unto them. And that's what children are constantly practicing in play. Children are learning, it's not all about me. My desires are not the same as your desires. So we've got to figure out one another's desires. And that's the basis for positive social interactions and the foundation of human morality, is the ability to understand other people's needs. And children are practicing that all the time in play. And play and emotional development. One of the theories of play that has come primarily from animal research is the emotional regulation theory of play. That when you look at young mammals, including young human beings, they very often play in risky ways. They, They climb trees too high. They swing from branch to branch where they can just barely make it and where they might get hurt if they fell. Goat kids run along cliffs. They could hurt if they fell. Children are constantly testing their ability to do something that is somewhat frightening to them as they swing higher in the swing or climb higher in the tree or skateboard down banisters or whatever it is they're doing. And parents want to stop them from doing that because it looks like they're going to break their neck. But what are children doing when they're doing that? They are testing their ability to behave in conditions that frighten them a little bit. Not frighten them so much that they're terrified, but frighten them so that they're feeling some fear and they're learning, I can overcome this fear. I don't have to panic. I can manage it. Well, what could be more important to learn than that? Well, there's probably other things that are equally important, but this is a very important thing to learn. All of us are going to, at some point in our lives, be in a real emergency where we're going to experience fear. And if we lose our heads in fear, we're lost. We won't be able to save our child, or we won't be able to save ourselves, or whoever it is that's in danger. We all have to learn how to experience and cope with fear, and children, as well as other young mammals, are practicing that in play. Children are also practicing how to manage anger in play. Inevitably, in play, kids get mad at one another. But if there's no adult there to go tattle to solve it, then you've got to solve the problem yourself. And a temper tantrum never works with a playmate. You just can't have a temper tantrum. And also, you know, if you lash out and hit, that's going to end the play. So you have to learn to deal more constructively with your anger. You have to learn to assert yourself because you don't want to be walked over. But at the same time, if you think this relationship is worth preserving and you think you really want to continue playing, you have to be able to assert yourself and to deal with your anger in a positive kind of way. So children are learning to deal with strong emotions in their play, with fear and with anger. And I already mentioned the play deprivation experiments with animals. If you deprive animals of the opportunity to play and then you test them in novel situations, they basically have panic attacks. They don't know how to deal with the fear and overcome it. So I'm going to conclude at this point and just say that the tragedy of today is that we are conducting a kind of play deprivation experiment with our children. We are not allowing our children the kind of free play, the kind of opportunities for social and risky play where there are not adults there to step in and solve the problems that I am arguing are essential for healthy physical, social, moral, intellectual, and emotional development. And with that, I'm going to conclude and thank you very much for your kind attention. Now, I think we have a little time before the library closes. If anybody has to leave, you should feel completely free to leave, but I can stay around for a while to address any questions or thoughts that do. Back there.
You identified one of the problems, you know, with allowing kids to play these days, is especially in an urban environment like this, parental concern about kids' safety and letting them just go off.
Right. Yeah, I mean, we are a society in which we are afraid of allowing our children to go out and play without being monitored and generally directed by adults. And how did this come about? Is it really that the world is that much more dangerous than it was in the 1950s? By most measures, it's not more dangerous. It's not the case. Well, so many people are worried about their children being snatched away by somebody. When you look at the actual statistics on that, the chance that your child will be snatched away by somebody if you're not watching the child is way less than the chance that your child will be hit by lightning. Lenore Skenazy, who wrote the book Free Range Kids, calculated that if you left your five-year-old on what might be regarded as one of the worst corners of New York City and waited for that child to be snatched away, statistically that child would be there for something like 100 years before being snatched away. People aren't that interested in your children, you know? So you know, every time it happens, of course, it does happen. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen. Kids, people get hit by lightning too. But every time it happens, we all hear about it. And the news media completely play it up, and all the experts are warning us. And now you can even be put in jail for letting your child play in the park without you watching them. There was this case of a woman who allowed her 9-year-old child. I mean, boy, by the time I was 5, I could go to the park and play myself. And this was in a completely safe park, and yet the police put this poor woman in jail for allowing her child to play in the park without watching her. This is the kind of world we've come to. We don't trust kids, and we believe that children who, that parents who trust their kids, who think their kids are smart enough to take care of themselves a little bit, we believe they're negligent parents. This is the first time in the history of humanity that we have had this kind of a view. There are studies done in some other cultures. For example, one of the studies I refer to in my book, Free to Learn, was done in a South Pacific island, where children between the age of 2 and 5 were observed by the researcher to be playing all day long by themselves, while their older siblings were in school and their parents were at work. And she watched them, and the 5-year-olds were perfectly competent to take care of the 2-year-olds. They played on cliffs. They played where there was glass. They played with machetes. When she told the parents they're playing with machetes, their only concern was they might ruin the machetes. They played with matches, and their parents' concern was they were wasting the matches. So here's a culture where 5-year-olds can take care of 2-year-olds. She said sometimes they would get into fights, but they were never serious fights. They never ran off tattling. They were emotionally extremely mature. I've done interviews of researchers who've studied hunter-gatherer cultures and have written a good deal about that. The belief among hunter-gatherer cultures is the age of reason is 4. Up until about age 4, children kind of need to be watched because they haven't incorporated the ability to follow rules, to think logically about things, to plan ahead, to know not to run out in the jungle and get eaten by a tiger. But by the age of 4, they have enough sense. They call this the age of sense. It's very interesting to me. I do some of my research at a school called the Sudbury Valley School, where children learn on their own initiative and through their own play. And from the beginning of that school, you had to be 4 years old to be accepted there because adults weren't watching you all the time. And they didn't think 3-year-olds were capable of having the ability to monitor themselves well enough, but 4-year-olds were. That school is now almost 50 years old. It's, to be precise, it's 47 years old. There has never been a case of a 4-year-old being seriously hurt. I don't mean, you know, there might have been a broken arm, but never a case of somebody being seriously hurt. There's a street they could run out to. There's woods they could get lost in. There's a pond they could drown in. It's never happened, even though the adults are not watching the 4-year-olds. I shouldn't say this too loud because somebody's going to close the school down if they hear this adult. But it's because the adults are not watching that the kids learn to be smart. They learn to take care of themselves, and they also kind of take care of one another. And that's what children are designed for. When we take that responsibility away from them, it becomes a kind of self-fulfilling prophecy that they can't do it anymore. They've got to grow up with the sense that they're responsible, that nobody is going to be monitoring them all the time and telling them exactly what to do. So I think that we do live in a world, unfortunately, where people are afraid to let their kids out. And I don't want to minimize the fact that there's traffic problems and there are some serious problems. There are some neighborhoods where there's drug dealers. The worst parents are often in the middle class neighborhoods where there's never been a a child murder. There's never been any of that. And yet those are the parents who stand out with the kid waiting for the school bus because they believe somebody's going to come and snatch their child away, standing at the end of the driveway waiting for the school bus. I mean, this is crazy. This is just absurd that we've gotten ourselves into this mental state. It's experts, people like me, but are on the other side of the fence on this, that help make us this way. They're constantly warning us. They're constantly telling us that we're bad parents if we don't constantly monitor our children. Where do you know where your child is today? Well, my parents never knew where I was, and they didn't want to know where. And I was glad they didn't know where I was once, you know. So at any rate, that's kind of a long answer to your question. Yeah.
Following on that, I grew up down the peninsula here in what used to be a middle-class neighborhood, not anymore. And actually, 2 doors down from me, my neighbor who was a teenager was murdered. And she became like one of these poster children for, because they thought that she was hitchhiking and she was a poster child for, like, you should never let your kids do anything by themselves. It was all over the media for a few years. They finally found her body, I think, like, over a year later. Well, anyway, so this whole time, and I was just terrified. I was, like, 6 years old as a kid. I stopped playing outside on my own. Everybody was terrified.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, realistically.
Right.
So. And about 3 years ago, it came out that she was actually murdered by her boyfriend at the time, and he was tried,
right.
And he's in jail now.
Right.
So, and it's interesting how all along, you know, the media portrays it as one thing, but it's not necessarily.
Yeah, we've got this, we went through this phase, I think we're kind of getting over it, of stranger danger, where children were always taught never speak to a stranger. Worst thing to tell a child, I mean, strangers, you oftentimes have to speak to a stranger. You need to have strangers often to help you if you've got a problem. You know, and people are so afraid that their child is going to be molested or abducted. The people who molest and abduct children are their priests, you know, their teachers, uncles, almost never a stranger. It is sometimes a stranger, but we have in our head that some stranger is going to do these things, and it is very, very rare that it is. And we are doing more harm to our children by not letting them out than that slight risk. There's always a risk. There is a risk. Everything is a risk. But of course, think about the difference between driving your child to school versus letting your child walk to school. We think that we are saving our child from the risk of abduction by driving the child to school, but the chance that that child is going to be killed in a traffic accident from your driving is probably greater than any chance that something terrible will happen as a result of walking to school. We're just very irrational. We aren't very good at figuring out statistics. We get these mental images in our head. Once you've got the image in your head of your child being molested by a stranger or killed by a stranger, you can't get that out of your head very easily. And it becomes very, and especially in the face of a society that is criticizing you if you allow your child, your 9-year-old child, to go to the park, you know, that becomes very hard to become a trustful parent. So I think that what we need to do is we need to work on this at community levels. We need to do things like develop playgrounds where there is an adult present who is there to monitor things, there to make sure that it's safe, there to reassure parents that things are okay, but who is trained not to intervene, is trained to be there. There are such people, particularly in the UK. There's a group that call themselves play workers. They don't initiate play, they don't interfere with play, but they're just there so that if something happens, so the children learn it doesn't pay to go and tattle to them because they're not going to intervene. they're not there to tell them what to do. They're not there to punish their playmate who has violated a rule. They're just there if there's a real emergency. And that makes it more acceptable to parents to leave their kids there. So I've been trying to push for that kind of thing. There are adventure playgrounds. There's one being developed in Cambridge, in Massachusetts. And there's a number of them being developed where there's somebody there. There's all kinds of great things to play with, including risky things to do, but there is an adult there, and that helps. So, yeah.
Kind of similarly, since there's a lot of times that parents are with their children,
right,
or caregivers are with their children, and a lot of times it's the parents who are directing kind of what seems like play.
Right.
I guess, what advice do you have to parents and caregivers to be able to make it a more
For parent, yeah.
When it's like parent and child.
Right. It's interesting. I have a colleague named David Lancey, a friend named David Lancey, who's probably the world's expert on children cross-culturally. And he tells me that the idea of parents playing with children is a uniquely Western idea. That in other cultures, a parent would never think it's their duty to play with their child. Children play with children, you know? And children are much better playmates than adults are for children. Children have the same energy level, they have the same interests, the same sense of humor. They aren't condescending, they don't try to turn it into teaching opportunities. They don't do all these things that spoil the play. Now, that being said, I have to confess that I actually do like to play with children. And I like to play with my own son when he was young. And I think the trick to doing it is, A, to find something that you both enjoy. Because it's not play for me. If I'm letting him be the boss and he's bullying me by playing in the way he wants to play and insisting that I play that way. So I've got to be just like another playmate and insist on my rights too. I'm not going to play that way. That's no fun for me. So you can't let your kid dominate you if it's play, and you can't dominate your kid. That's a little harder to do when you're 35 or 70 and the kid is 7 than it is if you are 9 and the kid is 7. Teenagers are great at playing with kids. Teenagers seem to, first of all, teenagers don't allow the little kids to bully them. They play in a way that is fun for both of them. They love to rough and tumble with little kids. Young adults like to do the same thing. I certainly like to do that as a father. You rough and tumble, throw your kid around and so on, and you know how to do it in such a way that it doesn't hurt, and you're having fun too, and giving piggyback rides and all of those kinds of things is great fun. And finding, when the kid gets older, finding some game that you both enjoy, and that either you can self-handicap at it in a way that makes it. So there are ways of playing with kids, but you have to be careful, A, that you're not dominating or trying to turn it into a teaching opportunity, and B, that you're not allowing yourself to be dominated. Because if you allow yourself to be dominated, you are reinforcing your child's narcissism rather than doing what a real playmate would be doing, which is not allowing your child to be narcissistic and to dominate and to be the center of all the attention. Yes?
I wonder if you've thought about, or if anybody doing this kind of research thinks about the kind of declining play as a sort of systemic cultural problem. Because I was thinking the correlation that you were making between mental illness and lack of play, I was thinking of the possibility that those two were symptoms of something even sort of more fundamental or more systemic. And I was just wondering if you had any ideas about how it is that we, as a culture, started losing striking to me. I was thinking, you know, that at one point in sort of cultural history, play happened naturally.
Right.
And now we've gotten to this point where we're starting to lose the ability to allow our kids to play.
Right.
And there's almost something that feels strangely like artificial, like now we're going to insert play back into our culture that sort of seems to defeat the kind of like fundamental idea of what play is.
Right. No, it's really a good point. And I think that we do have to find artificial ways to insert it back into our culture because it's not happening naturally. I think there are a number of things systemically that have caused the decline of play. One is the decline of neighborhoods. Play, when you knew your neighbors, you trusted your neighbors. And when you knew your neighbors, there were people around, and there was a sense of safety. If you knew your neighbor, wasn't a child molester, for example. So, and you, because you knew your neighbor's kids, and your kids knew one another. And so neighborhood play became possible. Most of us don't know our neighbors anymore because we work in different settings. Adults don't spend as much time at home. It used to be that women were home. Now, I'm not saying women should be home, but what I'm saying is that we solved one problem, emancipation of women, at the expense of another problem that we haven't figured out how to solve. How to have a neighborhood where children are safe to play, or where people feel that children are safe to play. So that's part of it. The other thing that's happened systemically is there has been this achievement drive in society generally. The idea that we hear constantly from Obama on down that we have to put our children from birth on into this achievement track so they will be prepared to be economically competitive in the coming times. And so childhood becomes a time of resume building rather than a time of play. We used to be much more relaxed about children. Children are just children. Get out of my hair, go out and play, was our attitude about children. Now we think of children as our responsibility, our duty. We've got to train them up. And that means that we have the responsibility of trying to shape them into something which we've become. It used to be that school occurred at school. When I was in elementary school in the 1950s, first of all, the school day was 6 hours long as it is today, but two of those hours were outdoors playing. We had a half hour recess in the morning, half hour recess in the afternoon, a full hour at lunch, and we could go everywhere we wanted. So we're really only in the classroom for 4 hours a day. We never had homework in elementary school. We had some in high school, but not in elementary school. We were free to play the rest of the time. Now think of school today. Little kids have homework. Little kids are being shamed because they aren't doing well in reading or this or that. And parents are being made to feel bad because their children are already falling behind. And here they are only in preschool or kindergarten or pre-kindergarten, whatever it is. I hear all the time from parents who feel that they're failures because they're getting these bad reports. That never used to happen. You know, children develop at different rates, but we expect them all to develop at the same rate and along the same track. So we've developed what I often call a schoolish mentality of child rearing, which is that children develop best when they are being guided and taught by adults, and that children's own activity is a waste of time. And I think that has come in part from school. School has become an increasingly powerful force in our society. It used to be that school was kind of confined to school, but now parents are supposed to monitor homework. They have to sign homework. They're expected to sign report cards. They're expected to pay attention to report. They're called in for meetings. Parents are made to feel guilty if their children aren't achieving in school, and so therefore parents get drawn into this kind of attitude that they've got to be continuously at their children to make them achieve. So I think those are some of the cultural things that are happening. Yes.
First of all, thank you for coming here. It's really great to hear you speak.
Thank you.
It makes me feel lucky to be able to teach a class on play at Texas State. What I was thinking about is related to technology, and I know there's a big technological boom happening, and maybe we can't even see what the results are.
Right.
I'm just curious if you have any thoughts on how having technological devices in the hands of young children is affecting their empathy. You talked about, you know, the ability to empathize, look one someone in the eyes, talk to them face to face. Do you feel like that form of play where it's more technological is hurting, you know, people's development or not?
Well, I think that first of all, I would never favor depriving children of computers and screens. Any more in our culture, any more than I would favor in a hunter-gatherer culture depriving them of knives and bows and arrows. The computer is the tool of today, and children naturally know what it is they have to learn. And to succeed in our culture today and in the future, you've got to be good at computers, just as a hunter-gatherer child has to be good at bows and arrows and digging sticks and tracking game and so on. Kids are drawn to the tools of their culture, and they want to play with those tools. And it's not surprising that children are better at learning those tools than we adults are. They learn how to program the VCR back when we had VCRs. They know how to use our computers and fix our computers and so on and so forth. And that's all wonderful. I would never deprive a child of that because I would be taking away. You know, the child who learns it young, it becomes an extension of their body. Now, it is true that children are playing with computers and we would like to see them playing outdoors more. And I think there is some empathy and so on going on. I think that part of the reason that children play with computers is the reason I just gave. They see it as the tool. Another part of the reason is, in a certain sense, that's the only place they're allowed to play. The same child who isn't allowed to venture by herself down to the corner grocery store on her own is allowed to enter this amazing virtual world that's exciting and so on, If we deprive that child of that, then we've deprived the child of all opportunity for adventure, all opportunity. My observation is that when children have a menu of possibilities, they can play with computers as much as they want, but they can also play outdoors as much as they want, and there's plenty of opportunity to play outdoors, and there are other kids to play outdoors with, they generally choose a balance. They choose some of both. There will be some who will just play with computers, and there will be some who will avoid the computers and play outdoors. We find this at Sudbury Valley School. Kids, in theory, could be on computers all day long. Kids, in theory, could be watching television all day long at the Sudbury Valley School, but they don't. They're playing outdoors a good share of the time. But there is variability. Just as when in the 1950s, when I was a kid, there were some kids who just read all the time. They didn't want to go out and play baseball or go fishing with me. I couldn't understand that. They just read all the time, but they turned out okay, you know? So I think of the kids who just play with computers, they're kind of like that. And in some ways, what's the difference between reading and playing with a computer? The computer involves more creativity than reading does. And some of these computer games are really quite incredible in terms of the social complexity of the game, the multiplayer games, and you're interacting with people in other settings and so on. Yes?
And it's in Psychology Today, you know. And I also wanted to tell you and everyone here that my husband and I are working, we have a website called backyardneighborhoods.org.
Uh-huh.
And backyardneighborhoods.org, and I'm hoping to make it more, user-friendly. But okay. Basically, we're just trying to connect people who would like to find other people who want to either take fences down or lower their fences or put gates in their fences, and then kind of post when something on their block is available for sale or for rent, so that people who want to have a big backyard neighborhood can get together, and then the children can play safely and spontaneously, and just kind of have the old-fashioned neighborhood, but not to have to worry about the traffic in the streets.
Right. That's wonderful. Thank you. Send me a link to it so I can send it to others. Great. Yeah, do you know of the work of Mike Lanza? There's a fellow named Mike Lanza who wrote a book called Playborhood. He's actually located out here someplace. And he also has a website called Playborhood. And he took on the problem, lives in a middle-class neighborhood, maybe an upper-middle-class neighborhood, where has young children discovered that nobody was outdoors playing, and he took it upon himself to solve that problem. And he did it by putting his kids' playground equipment in the front yard rather than the backyard, so other people would see it. He put a nice sandbox there. He put water play there. He put their own family picnic table in front yard instead of back. So it made a neighborhood. Other people got to know them. His kids got to know other kids. He basically put up a please trespass sign on their lawn so that everybody would come and play there, and so suddenly his kids had friends. And he wrote a book that was described that, but also described in six other kinds of neighborhoods, including an inner city poverty neighborhood and various other places, how a group of parents or a parent took it upon themselves to solve the problem of recreating neighborhood play in that setting. And what he shows in that book is that although we think of this as a problem that can't be solved, it's an eminently solvable problem. All we have to do is want to solve it and take a little bit of effort to do it. Maybe more than a little bit of effort, but some effort to do it. We can do it, but we have to want to do it. There's ways of making neighborhood play come back again. Yes?
I just wanted to add, there's a wonderful work called The Furry Child, where they really scholarly take a look at kinds of ways we're rushing kids past things that are necessary for them to develop naturally.
Right, that is a good book. Yes, I'm on the right here.
I just want to mention that there is a Sudbury Model School in the Bay Area. It's over in Concord, Diablo Valley School, a short walk from a BART station, which your children could do alone if you trusted them. just mentioning. And so we have an open house on October 18th.
Thank you for mentioning that. Yes.
My youngest actually takes advantage of that school. And uh-huh. I'm very pleased. But my comment and question is actually something different. I am also a parent to two autistic young adults.
Right.
We're fortunate in that they're older than most of the wave of diagnoses, and so they participated in the usual play-based preschool programs. I myself was trained as a constructivist and sought those mm-hmm. places out for my children. But when they then moved into the only available school at the time that I was aware of, which was a fairly traditional model, play went away, and suddenly their differences were dramatically exacerbated.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if you have looked at, or if other people you are aware of have looked at, the implication of continuing a play-based model for children who are identified on the spectrum. Because right now,
right.
the modality is primarily a very controlled, step-by-step, break it into little bites kind of modality.
Interesting, yeah.
And I don't really put a lot of stock into that with my own experience.
That's interesting. I am by no means an expert on that. What I can say is that I've seen at Sudbury Model Schools, I've seen cases of kids who've been diagnosed on the autistic spectrum, and observing the kids, I definitely believe they're on it, who do very well there. And I've also known at least one case of somebody who's probably farther out on that spectrum who didn't do very well. Because the problem is, if you are completely, you know, if you're far enough out on the spectrum, you're not paying any attention to what other people are doing, and you're not interested in making connections, and you're not playing. And no matter how much the other kids would try to draw them out, they couldn't be drawn out. The cases where I've seen it be very successful, I think in every case, it was an autistic boy who loved computers and who was very good at computer games and drew other friends around the computer activities and became increasingly social and able through the computer activities. So I do think that, and as I'm sure you know, that one of the kinds of therapies for autism is to try to teach play in a way. And what you're probably saying is, how do kids learn play? Do they learn it by teaching step by step, or do they learn it by being immersed in a playful setting? Yeah. Right. And you kind of even have to wonder why there are a lot of theories as to why autism is so much more prevalent today than in the past. And is it in part that in the past there would have been a lot of kids who maybe were kind of on the autistic spectrum, but they played, they were immersed in age-mixed play, they had a lot of siblings to play with, and they overcame it in a sense. I don't know. I'm just speculating. Well, I think we have to probably draw to a close because I'm told the library just simply shuts down at some point. So, good luck, Sally.